Namo Gurudeva
Gather here camaraderie and vibrancy, and with a sense of courage, being together to ask difficult questions and look into a difficult part of ourselves and the world. It's nice to have a sense of community here. See if we can find a level of quietude or stillness by synchronizing awareness, breath, and the sensations, whatever arises. See if we can do that so that we can come open enough to listen to our heart, listen to ourselves, and also listen to our friend here compassionately. So I want you to really gently invite your breath into your body, whatever arising in your body, in your emotions, in your subtle body level, without any judgment or pushing it away. If you can listen, welcome. We do that with breath. I really want this to be an opportunity for you to really reflect, digest, metamorphize, and integrate. What did you notice? Breath is already breathing, you know? See if you can connect this plumb line I called central channel, where you can get stabilized, where you can get nurtured, where you can connect to your intention to be here today. So when you invite breath or open to your breathing, see if you can feel the expansion of the belly, expanding the horizontally, all your relations, connections, connected the horizontally beyond the space. Notice and listen to the quality or tone of the breath, as if you are getting a news from the body, information from your own body. What's the feeling tone of the pulse between the breath, or at the top of the inhale and at the bottom of the exhale? So as you inhale, see if you can bring together all the relations beyond the boundary of the space. And as you exhale, see if you can bring or gather this whole history of time, past, present, and the future to be one into your plumb line, central channel. So suspend temporarily the past, future, and the present, as if like this, three-dimensionally, or beyond the dimension, this fourth time. So inhale, connect all relations beyond the space. Exhale, vertically, beyond the time. Then again, I want you to connect your intention to be here today. What's need to come out from today's gathering? What I would like to see from today's meeting, then make your intention as vast as the ocean, as vast as the sky, including entire relationships, relations, space, beyond the space and time, including all beings right here, right now. So with all of our dedication and effort, we all have this intention of climb up the mountain path that our past great masters laid out for us. And yet we found ourselves sometimes feeling detouring ourselves way from the path and falling into a sense of doubt or despair. Doubt about our capacity to tread the path. doubt about the path itself. And even being lost in the forest of this profound path. Am I the only one? I certainly have that feeling. Then my question is, what is it that makes you return again and again and again to our community like here? But somehow you decided, you returned again and again to this kind of small gathering of practitioners. What drives us to be on the cushion practice, sitting practice, and gathering of practitioners or practices itself? Just take a moment to think about it. This morning I was thinking about this metaphor I often talk about. It's no longer a metaphor, actually literal. I often talk about the jump off the cliff. So I feel like we were standing at the edge of a cliff, looking down at the river before, but now some forces pushed our back to throw us into the river of uncertainty, river of fear, river of despair. Now we are in the river already. It's not the time for us to go back, climb up to the cliff and go back to the illusionary place where we were before. Many of us would like to do that, but the world we knew has gone. Illusionary world has passed. It is not the time for trying to go back to the cliff where we were. Let's admit it. It is the time for swimming now for us. Swimming and for putting our practices and our skill we build up, whatever levels, or even just willingness we cultivate it to be exercised. I don't know, that's how I feel. Then putting our practice on test, so to speak. Now we are tested. You know, swimming skill may not be perfect. Definitely I am not. I was not really ready, but I feel I have a responsibility because of this opportunity I have, like here, opportunity for practice, opportunity to have a company, companionship here like this. So now we have to trust our swimming skill, whatever level swimming skill we have, capacity. But ultimately, we have to trust in our innate capacity, which is perfect. Basic perfection, basic goodness, don't you think? Without that, we will not be here. This fundamental trust, absolute confidence in one's own true nature. This is the time for spiritual practices to be exercises and have effect and our skill to be tested. In this, or on this note, we need two things. I often emphasize, especially last year and this year, we've been kind of exploring, but we need two things. One is a community like this, and another is practice. Practice itself. Just under the community, it's nice, comforting, but that's not to grow. We have to have our own personal practice and the community both go together. Then in terms of community, we are swimming all, not me. Everybody is on the same boat, so it's the same river. We need to support each other when we are swimming. Then we look for the heartfelt connection, connectivity. You know, this human connection, humanness, you know, connecting. Heartfelt connectivity where we can stay connected with our vulnerabilities, our humanness, soft-heartedness, so that we can keep our heart open. That's what we are not going after, but that's what we are looking for, no? Complete open-heartedness of Bodhisattva. We have a little bit open, maybe only our beloved or, you know, somebody very close. But then our practice is to unveil more and more that little crack we have, a key to complete openness. We want to wide open. For that, we need to stay connected to our vulnerabilities. We have to know our own suffering, for example. For that, we need this kind of community to really hear, compassionately listen to us, and where we can speak with authenticity and honesty. And, you know, I feel very sad today. I can say like that to you here. Then somebody says, oh, me too, I feel sad. You know, that sort of environment, kind of safe environment where we can stay vulnerable. So that's one of the things in terms of communities I would like to see. So this is a place where we can reflect and digest, transform, or integrate, or embody, and develop the capacity, which I was talking about, capacity to be present in the world. We all wish to be present in the world of suffering, no? But that work has to start from here, inner work, internal work. About maybe you also have some idea about what the function of this kind of community, you know, camaraderie, vibrancy of community, importance of that at this time. And in terms of practice, see, we need a practice which directly work with fear. Fear of vulnerability or whatever arises. Work directly with those fears, distress, anxieties, or what else? What else coming up for you? These they name it, right? May not necessarily just what's happening externally, just that might trigger our burden, so to speak. Body carries so much, we cannot imagine what's carried. But then lots of things, stuff comes up. We need a practice to really directly work with that sort of stuff, uncertainty, right? Fear is always based on uncertainty, for example, nowadays. So that's one, that sort of practice, we need that. You can say gods and demons, and directly work with gods and demons, because that impede not only temporary happiness in here, like a day-to-day basis, but also ultimate happiness, you can say awakening. Like Machik said, unless we have gods and demon liberated, enlightenment is impossible. So anyway, so that sort of a practice we need to have. And also practice to cultivate or unveil this fierce compassion. I call it fierce compassion. Not only just the wishy-washy compassion. That's very fierce compassion. Like a mother have when she jump into the river without any hesitation to save a drowning child. So how can we cultivate that sort of fierce compassion? And the fierce compassion that uphold all other beings as if they are your own children or your beloved or your mother. That sort of practice we need. So we are reflecting on this because our world has been in such a channel ground, turmoil, as if they were like channel ground. Do you agree? Yeah, it's obvious. So then a turmoil want to get better. We want to 2021, you know, it's things are getting better, you know, vaccines coming and, you know, some teachers talking about, oh, this year, we just had a new year, right? Tibetan New Year. So this year is very grounded and things get better and better. You know, we hope so. In one sense, one level, yes. But another level always has been like this. Just the difference is the symptoms manifest more in an extreme way. For us as a practitioner, this is the opportunity. This is the time for transformation. As I was talking about, we are forced jump into the river. Now it's time to really go into the deeper practice, deeper learning and the reflection, the renewal and the healing. So it's important to recognize suffering is occurring. We don't want to deny that. Oh, now it's getting better. Yes, in one sense, maybe fewer people dying, but in a deeper level, suffering is occurring in our humanity. And also it's important to be emotionally kind and responsive to our own suffering. So what do you think? So what we are asked for, so to speak, this time, not talking about as a practitioner or something like that, just a human being, human citizen this time. I often talk about this, to be truly human and to truly be present or to be awake. The same, it's the same, but we have an opportunity. Yes, we need our community and our practice, our path or journey. So that I was talking about, Chobastari journey or Mahamudra journey, Dakini journey, Dakini whisper journey itself. Not necessarily in our community, I'm talking about in general, that sort of path is necessary, and the reflection and the healing and the renewal. So in this way, we have been called to not only on the cushion practice, more like being called to live our practice off the cushion more than ever. It seems like my focus or emphasis or talking about off the cushion or the integration of the practice, because we cannot avoid what's happening externally and internally. And the true practice is really the practice for integration, union or fusion of compassion and empathy.